I'm Filip Boyen, CEO of Forbes Travel Guide, and I warmly welcome you to our Stronger Together webinar series. Our Hospitality Strong series earlier this year was a smashing success with over 55,000 total registrations. We are delighted to be back with more. We recorded the further six conversations with some of the most respected leaders in travel and hospitality, and they can all be found on the Forbes Travel Guide YouTube channel. Today, we take a closer look at the Middle East, which is overseen by my colleague Chris Fraden, SVB for EMEA and APAC. We are also joined by three wonderful hoteliers for which we have a great deal of respect. We have Simon Casson, President Hotel Operations for Europe, Middle East and Africa, Four Seasons Hotels and Resorts; Sandeep, Walia, Area Vice President, UAE, Marriott International; and Bastien, Blanc, Managing Director, KSA and Bahrain with IHG. Simon oversees Four Seasons Hotel Operations across a portfolio that ranges from palace hotels in Europe to glittering skyscrapers in the Middle East, hideaway beach resorts, and a luxury safari lodge in Africa. Simon says each Four Seasons must earn its reputation with every guest, every day. Incredible properties attract guests, but it's what happens inside that brings the story of Four Seasons to life. Simon sees his role as that of every Four Seasons employee as a brand ambassador, exceeding the expectations of even the most well-traveled guests, with the customized service and individual experiences that will continue to be the cornerstone of the company's success. Simon joined Four Seasons in 1989 as an assistant manager at what is now the Four Seasons Hotel London Park Lane. In 2005, he opened Four Seasons Hotel Doha and was promoted to regional VP in 2011, before moving to Dubai for the brand's first opening in the UAE in 2014. He was promoted to his current position in 2016 and is now based in Dubai. Simon's next travel destination is a motorbiking trip through Croatia and Greece. Simon, I also hear that you sing, and apparently you bought a baby grand piano, but you don't know how to play it. What's up with that?
Well, firstly, thank you for that. I don't think I've ever been so beautifully introduced, Filip. I feel like Elvis has walked out on the stage. Listen, I think life's all about trying new experiences. So yeah, the piano's a work in progress. I suspect it will be a lifelong work in progress. And due to lockdown, I've ended up being longer here in Croatia than I anticipated. But really happy to join you, Filip, the Forbes team, and my colleagues on the call here today.
Well, it's great to have you with us, Simon. And now Sandeep, in his current role, he oversees 59 properties with more than 17,000 rooms. Marriott's portfolio in the UAE features 19 brands across its luxury, premium, and select brand portfolio, consisting of some of the world's most prestigious hospitality brands, including the Ritz-Carlton, Bulgari, St. Regis, Edition, the Luxury Collection, JW Marriott, W Hotels, Autograph Collection, Marriott Hotels, and Sheraton. Sandeep joined Marriott International in 2005. Prior to moving to the Middle East, he was the Area Vice President Luxury Brands for Western Europe. Having worked for luxury brands across continents, including Asia, Middle East, Africa, and Europe, he has a global mindset and a key understanding of the consumer and their evolving needs and aspiration. Of Indian origin, Sandeep currently resides in Dubai with his wife, Kriti. Sandeep, if I see all these brands here, I'm getting confused. How do you deal with that?
Oh, that's not confusing at all. It's 19 brands in UAE, though Marriott otherwise has 30 brands, but in UAE we are represented by 19. So it's like 19 swim lanes, and you just stick to the swim lane and you're good to go.
Well said. We are excited to have you with us, Sandeep.
Thank you.
And Bastien is responsible for driving IAG's growth and performance in Saudi Arabia, with the aim to maintain IAG's strength in KSA. Bastien has a deep understanding of the market markets. In his previous role with IAG, he was the Vice President of Operations Middle East and was responsible for the performance of 90 hotels across the region. Having worked with hospitality brands such as Accor and Interstate Hotels, Bastien is an industry veteran and brings with him over 25 years of hospitality experience. With senior management positions in commercial development and operations across North America, Europe, Russia, India, Middle East, Africa, and the Indian Ocean. Wonderful to have you with us, Bastien.
Thank you so much. You make it sound like I'm packing and repacking very often, you know. All those moves are exhausting, but it gave really a good opportunity to discover the world.
Well, packing and unpacking, Bastien, is one of the wonderful things of our profession, don't you think?
I fully agree. After living in 12 different countries, I wouldn't complain, you know.
Thank you. Let's get to the topic. So, Simon, let's come to you first. So, how are your properties doing right now? What service modifications have you had to make? And how are your guests reacting to those changes?
Wow, that's three questions in one. How long do we have for that?
I mean,
first of all, I'm sure my colleagues would agree, you know, this has been a catastrophic pandemic for the hospitality and many other industries around the world. And for sure, Four Seasons nor any hotel company is immune to that. So, you know, I oversee 40 hotels, as you mentioned, across the region. They pretty much all closed at one point. Right now, I have 32 of the 40 back open. Some big flagships reopening this month, like our Georges V in Paris, and opening a brand new hotel, in Madrid. Business levels are poor. No other way to describe it. However, they're certainly going in the right direction. Listen, we've actually had some surprisingly good results in some resorts in Hampshire and the British countryside, in Saint-Jean-Cap-Ferrat in the south of France, in Megève in the Alps. You know, hotels where we have space and where the guests feel there is space and you can, you know, feel not crowded in. And so we've been running occupancies in the 60s, 70s in some instances there. Our resort in Seychelles has been fully booked on and off for the past month or so with some private families. But we also have other city center hotels that are still in single digit occupancy. So across the region, you know, high 20s, which are numbers that we never thought we would be dealing with. And it's been a challenging time, but also a very interesting time. And I think great moments and opportunities for leadership. What have we had to change? Firstly, you have to have a generation of hoteliers learn how to close down hotels. Many of them, you know, majority have never done that before. For some of the younger generation, this is, you know, the first big crisis they faced in senior leadership. So having a hand on the shoulder, guiding through and, you know, showing reassurance in leadership that, you know, the industry and the world has done and will continue to go through many cycles and we'll ride this one out like everything else. But then significant change, of course, given the global nature of the crisis. You know, we've had pandemics before, but they tended to have been regionalized in different parts of the world. The global impact of Corona is difficult because as a global company, if something happened in Asia, we tended to balance it with good results in Europe. So it's truly global in nature, the downturn.
Right.
And then in terms of the response, how you change, how you welcome and really interact on every touch point with our guests. You know, we're a very simple business in hospitality, but it's simply complex because a great experience is made up of, you know, those thousands of little interactions and details every day. And we've had to take a look at every one of those and see how do they appropriately need to be adjusted to ensure that they're safe. And we've done that in a very thoughtful way through our Lead with Care program. A lot more detail about it, but that's the sort of headline news.
Fantastic. Thank you, Simon. And Sandeep, how has the pandemic impacted your region and has it affected your growth plans in Asia?
I think I remain cautiously optimistic about the business, first of all. I think the glass is half full. And I would make it real in a minute, but I think somewhere once the vaccine is found or a cure is found, or whatever that solution looks like, I think there's a huge amount of pent up demand, and travel will be back, and we'll be looking at those high occupancy numbers. I mean, you already cited some numbers. We have 59 hotels in the UAE. 80% of the hotels are open today. Like Simon said, there was a day when most of our hotels were closed. I would say there was a bit of a hedge, if I had to use a financial term, because some of our resorts or hotels like the Grosvenor House or the Marriott Harbour, they have residential component. So they really didn't close because they still maintained the 80% occupancy with the residential component. So those were the hotels that stayed open, but the rest closed. But today, when you look at it, 80% are open. Are the numbers something to be proud of? No. But however, when you look at the fact that you've gone from 0% to what we've done in August, I think it's been more positive than what we thought it would be. But there is a bit of a particular nature in that for UAE as well. And I would say if business is returning, it's returning in three different phases. One is what we are in right now, and that's staycations, daycations, something which we never used before. But this is to resorts. Like, I mean, if it's on the beach, the St. Regis Saadiyat or Royal Meridian or Ritz-Carlton Dubai or Bulgari. The other side is the desert properties like the Almaha or the Ritz-Carlton Al Wadi. So people have been kind of getting out of home as soon as they could. And second is the F&B in this category. I mean, food and beverage has been really doing well, and even in September continues to do well. So that's the encouraging part, and I think lends to my saying the glass is half full, and people will start to travel when something is found. So I think that's where we are today. But if you had to look at the journey, I would say the phase two would be somewhere the regional travel. We've hearing a bit positive on Saudi opening up, Oman opening up on 1st October. So I feel besides Bastien starting to travel to Dubai, we're going to have a lot of other regional travel starting as well. So I think that will be the phase two, and then the international travel. But mind you, international travel, we are open today if somebody wants to come in UAE. So that's pretty open. But you said, I think second part of the question was how are the openings going, or how is the
how is your growth affected?
Yeah, growth is not impacted at all. I think everybody has a futuristic view on it. We do have 22 hotels in UAE in the pipeline, and 12 out of them open actually next year. And so far, I wouldn't say all are on track in terms of the timing, but all are on track to open next year. And it's a bit of a snapshot of a moving picture. But if I had to take the snapshot right now, we do open St. Regis the Palm in the beginning of the year, and that will be one of the first few openings next year. But I think it also comes with a bit of optimism because we do have the expo in UAE in 2021, the latter part. I think that lends to that optimism as well. So currently, it's robust and as it was planned.
That sounds great. Thank you. And Bastien, with the Vision 2030 in Saudi Arabia, hospitality in the kingdom is developing at lightning speed. So how has COVID impacted your properties and the ambitious growth plans in the country?
Well, I would like to start very positively, because at the end of the day right now, with the way the rules are being relaxed in the country, you can see really a huge growth, especially with the domestic market. So we still have lots of resorts in KSA. And when you think Middle East, you think resort by the seaside. But actually in KSA, because of the very diverse landscape, you also have resorts in the mountains, like Taif, for instance. So InterContinental Taif, InterContinental Al Jubail have been doing very well during the summer, running occupancy over the 90%. So wow. No, it's not the case of every single hotel, but you can see really there is a domestic interest and the drive to visit the country much more than what happened before. And we hope that now with the international travel reopening, the international tourism as the government opened 50 countries with visa on arrival over a year ago now, we'll be able to see a growth of that international market as well. Basically, if you look at how COVID has changed the way we're looking at the business, so first of all, we have seen a very interesting focus of the clientele on cleanliness. If you look at the comments left by the guest, over 30% of the comments over the past 6 months have been about being thankful about the cleanliness and the safety of the standard provided. We have been working with our partners like Diversey, Ecolab, as well as the Cleveland Clinic to push what we call our IG clean ways or ways of clean one step further in order to address the new challenges that have been brought by COVID. So again, developing further concept that we have that have been at the heart of what we do forever, but that have been adapted in order to meet the new challenges of COVID. Also, it gave the opportunity to invest further in technology. We have been able to develop much faster all the check-in, check-out online process through the phone, for instance, as well as the pay with point that has been a key element of our policy because technology is all about developing contactless solutions. And that has been really at the main focus over the past few months to develop those solutions quicker for our guests to feel safer. And I would like to come back to a point that was mentioned by my colleague, which is our colleagues, because we have to remember that we are an industry of people. And right now we need to adapt to the new guest expectations because yes, the guests still have the expectation to have a nice time, to discover a new location and to have an experience when they go to our properties. But the way they want to experience it is different from before. The famous smile behind the mask that has been at the heart of the training we have been delivering to our colleagues in order to make sure they understand how to engage with the guest. Because this distance from the social distancing has been a bit changing the way you approach service. And we have been giving trainings like this throughout all the departments, not only the front of house, but back of house as well, in order to ensure our team, our colleagues, understand how to engage with the guest within the new COVID world.
Excellent. Thank you for sharing that. Simon, for young people wanting to make a career in hospitality today, this crisis can be discouraging, right? What advice would you give if you were, again, 21 years old?
Oh, goodness, that's a big question, Filip. Firstly, I would say it's still a business that's filled with the joy, excitement, potential, and opportunity that all of us, you know, on this call today have found. And it's one of the rare businesses where you can start at the bottom and work your way through and get up to the highest levels based on your talent. It's a meritocracy. You know, it's really about who is the best person for the job, who can grow and develop themselves the most, who can adapt, who's prepared to work harder and sacrifice more to get up there. For me, it's just the most marvelous industry. And I don't think there's ever a good time, you know, or a bad time to join. If you join at the height of a boom, for sure, along the years of your career, you're going to have to deal with a downturn. So I would say to, you know, a young person joining, don't worry about the entry point. Don't worry about where the industry is in a cycle. Firstly, be sure for yourself that you're passionate about hospitality. It's not a business that you can be half in. It's not a business that you can be half passionate about because it's extraordinarily demanding and much so in your younger formative years in the career probably than when you get up to a more senior level. So you have to really have a passion for it and want to be in the business. And I think once you've decided that, then I would just, you know, encourage a younger version of myself to say, you know, what type of company do you want to work for? What are your own values? You know, our business and industry is very diverse. We go, you know, across, you know, from motorside lodges to grand palaces, and they're all doing, you know, generally the same thing. None are better or worse than the others. They're just all pitched at a different point in the market. So give some right. thought to what part of the industry you'd like to be in, and know that every part of the industry has a value. But important, find a home, find somewhere that you belong, because when you're working long hours and it's very demanding, it's easier to do that if you think that, you know, your time and toil has meaning, and has purpose. And you're giving that talent and time that you have to something that has value. And also that there is a balance. If you're working hard, you feel that you're treated with respect, that your voice is listened to, that you're given training and development, that you see it is a meritocracy and you are going to grow and develop respective of your gender or place of birth. You're going to grow and develop based on your talent and what you have to bring to the table. Because I believe everyone turns up at whatever job you're doing and wants to be great at it. It's only poor management, weak leadership that becomes an impediment to that. Most employees, 99%, want to be great at what they do. So a lot of the job of leadership is getting out of the way, letting the employees flourish, but making sure that the environment is fertile for their growth. But I'm excited today, as I was at 21, to be in this industry and feel extraordinarily fortunate that I've been able to have a lifetime, within what is one of the great vocations.
Yep. So Sandeep, you want to build on that? What would you say to a young hotelier when he asks you, how can I be successful in this business?
Yeah, I think Simon said so much. Now I need to kind of say, okay, I should not be repeating what Simon said. But I think picking up from what Simon already said, the one word I picked from him and then I'll add to it is, the first word would be passion. I think it's a bit overused as a word, but it's the right word. It's the fact that you need to be passionate about this industry. You need to have that energy. You need to have the interest, which will keep you excited every day. And often when one is talking to young hoteliers and you say passion and they're kind of looking at you saying, oh, we've heard of this word so much. It's almost like, just to kind of give you an example, when you take water, you heat it up, you heat it up to 99 degrees. It's hot water. I guess if you put your hands into, now that I've tried it, Filip, but if you put your hands into 99 degrees water, you're going to burn your hand. But then you heat it that 1 degree more, it turns into steam. And that steam, when some of us were younger, used to move trains and engines. And it's just that 1 degree difference, which kind of makes it from harming you to such energy. And I think that 1% is the passion. And what I mean by that is the fact that there is something always driving you to do that 1% more when you are into this industry. And if you have that passion, that energy to keep going and having something which is going to be that 1% for you, I think then this is the right industry, because it does tend to take a lot of your time. So you need that passion to kind of remain attached to it. And I think the second I think the second thing I would add to that is to a young hotelier who's joining is to say, just treat it as your business. Be an entrepreneur in thinking, be an entrepreneur as a leader, because even a person who's just started, whether it's at the reception or at a restaurant, or is it assistant manager or whichever position he might or she might be in. I think as far as that person remains passionate and thinks about it as, what would I do if this was my money? What would I sell or upsell, or how would I look after this particular guest if it was my restaurant, because I wanted positive ratings on my restaurant?
Great.
I think if you can treat it that way, you're going to be successful.
Fantastic. Thank you, Sandeep. So, Bastien, what have you learned from this crisis? And do you feel you are better prepared should this ever happen again?
So definitely this crisis has revealed a lot of creative thinking, because what people were considering as things that cannot be changed have been totally put upside down and have forced the whole team, the management, the colleagues to really find solutions which are much more adapted to the new normal of today. You talk about remote working. You talk about more flexible working, because we already implemented a few years ago flexible working. But it was never planned for the whole office, for instance. And that's what we have been doing now for close to 6 months. So all those kind of new ways to work have been deployed without too much pain. And thanks to the creative thinking and the quick reaction of the team, showing that we can address any kind of challenges thrown our way. It meant as well that we had to adapt the way we are working, because we think about remote working, but we need to think about how we keep the engagement with the team, how we remain with the connection. There is no more coffee machine discussion, you know? So for instance, we had to review the way we are communicating to the team from the senior leadership point of view. We had to create some counseling, which we call the employee assistance program, in order to help our colleagues transition to these new ways of working. Even a family network, because some of the colleagues were really in a difficult situation, working from home, leaving home, how do they really work between the two bosses, the one at work and the one at home? And this has been a transition as well that we have been working on. And to keep it short, we have also kept on investing on technology and on brands, because basically technology is part of the contactless solution that we're providing to the guest, and also the loyalty, making sure that we keep on building strong brands for our guests to keep on traveling, because we do believe that we will travel again as extensively as we used to do, and we are dedicated to be part of this.
Wonderful. Simon, what have you been most proud of from your company over the last 6 months?
You know, it's really reinforced for me the value of integrity in a brand, the value of trust in a brand, because to encourage guests to return, you have to start off with, you know, a significant amount of brand trust. And then you have to look at how can you enhance that. And, you know, we're a relatively small company, we're a niche player. But I've been very proud of how the whole organization pivoted very quickly. Didn't sort of feel sorry for itself, didn't lick its wounds, changed into remote working very seamlessly. And then really established ourselves a leadership group of how could we every day support the hotels, working right with the ownership partners, working with the corporate office. And then I'm particularly proud that, you know, we recognized early that whatever you say you're going to, and everyone, of course, is going to be trying their best to show that we're safe. You know, we partnered very early with John Hopkins Medical International out of Baltimore with a consulting partnership with them. And we've really integrated them into our team and advisory board. And we've made sure, not only with them, with other industry partners that we've worked with as well, with International SOS, with Ecolab and others, how quickly we were able to put resources together. We established a COVID portal, a warehousing for all the information, every change standard, every communication. And so I've been impressed by our nimbleness, by our resilience, and by the flexibility and continued passion of the people of Four Seasons that have kept me smiling, kept me laughing, and kept me believing that this too shall pass and better days will come.
Wonderful. And Sandeep, we all know that this pandemic has accelerated a lot of things. What would you say will be the top two for our industry?
Good question. I think there are a lot of things which have got speeded up, I would say. They were always there, but they've got speeded up. But if I had to choose two, the first would be the fact that I think we were already on a journey of people moving from product to experiences. And I think that was even more in the luxury part of our business, where people were moving from product luxury into experiential. Instead of buying a watch or a bag, we saw more and more luxury guests moving into experiences and going for a week of some sort of an experience somewhere. I feel that's got speeded up. And that is something which could be, to use the word new normal, I think that could be something that would be staying with us for a long time. I mean, even if we look at now, we clearly know that leisure business is going to come first, then it's going to be the corporates, and then it's going to be the groups. But I think the leisure part, people would have more time for their families. They would like to experience more because they value it more today. So I think that's one thing that has speeded up. The second thing I would say is, I'm quickly trying to prioritize the top two, but I would say it's people. And I think people are were and always will remain the most important for this part of the business. But I think it's even got speeded up more to realize that people are the most important. We as Marriott own brands. We don't really, except few, we don't own too many hotels. So what we own is brands. Now, if you look at a brand, it's kind of a seal of approval. And that's going to, it's going to increase. When somebody is traveling to their family, they're going to choose a hotel which is branded because there is a seal of approval of either hygiene or cleanliness or service or whatever comes with that brand. Whether it is a Loft or an Element, whether it is a Sheraton or a Meridian or at the higher end, a Ritz-Carlton or St. Regis, but that's what comes with it. Now, who's the brand? It's not the logo, it's the people. And tomorrow when a guest is going to walk in and somebody at the reception didn't use a clean pen by mistake, it's not going to be that Tom didn't give a clean pen. It's going to be that particular brand didn't do it right. So I think it's become even more important. And during these times, I've seen that people have risen to the occasion. They believed in the fact that we're all in it together. And they're standing by every standard that you roll out. And therefore, the importance is back to people because they are the ones who are forming the brand. So I think people, the importance of people has got speeded up even more.
Excellent. Thank you, Sandeep. Simon, we all know that Four Seasons is the brand with the most Forbes five-star hotels within any brand. So this is an easy one for you. So many say that Four Seasons is the standout world leader in luxury hospitality. What, in your eyes, is the difference between good and great?
Well, firstly, I need a Forbes sign like Sandeep has behind him to put in my home office here so I can help promote your brand. Brand as well. But listen, good for me, it's very clear. Good can be built, you know, and we're a hotel operator. We're not a hotel owner. We partner with some amazing owner partners who make huge investments to create iconic hotels. But it's a piece of land. It's an architectural building. It's marble, it's wood, it's gold, it's paintings. But that's achievable by anyone. Anyone who has money is able to create that. And so it can never be great if it's just achievable with money. But, you know, the quantum leap from good to great is human. It's no great surprise. It's people. It's delivered by humans through anticipation, through genuine caring, through connecting with people, through wanting to create memorable moments. And that's the differentiator. You know, we're opening a new hotel in Madrid in a couple of weeks. It's a fantastic historical building, really iconic. But just because you open and put the Four Seasons tree on the door doesn't mean it's going to be great. No, it's the people of that hotel, starting with the general manager and working with the whole team, that become the sort of lifeblood that pumps through the veins of that hotels and brings it alive and creates the magic. So great is all around the humanity of people. And, you know, in Four Seasons, we're richly endowed with that.
Fantastic. Thank you, Simon. And Bastien, we recently did our second Leading Edge of Luxury survey. 420 luxury hotels worldwide took part. And the responses show that 54% of the hotels feel that the worst is over. The most pessimistic are the Central and South Americans. Only 15% felt that. But in the Middle East, we were all surprised. The properties there are incredibly positive, with 85% that feel that the worst is over. What is that optimism based on?
Well, I would say that's really the destination driving it. You look at Dubai. Dubai has been one of the first destinations really reopening to the world. And the resorts, especially resorts, have been driving the demand. And you have still a huge interest for people to come and visit Dubai. You look at KSA, you look at Oman, you have lots of domestic clientele, which is a strength of those countries that many other countries do not have, unfortunately, that will really be part of the rebound and the new business that we are looking at for the coming few months. So they can be optimistic, they are right to be optimistic, and with the creative thinking which is developed by the hotels to develop new activities based on the new type of clientele, not addressing systematically the international clientele anymore, but much more of domestic clientele requiring a different experience. We will definitely have very interesting months ahead of us.
The survey also showed that the percentage of hotels that expect a recovery to take 2 years or more has increased over the last 6 weeks from 26 to 41%. Slightly worrying, I would say. What is your perspective on the future and the recovery?
Listen, recovery will come. It's all a question of what's the runway towards that and what's the speed of it going to be. And are we going to have some speed bumps along the way? You know, I think, you know, we're at a particular moment where we've gone through the first phase and everyone manages through a crisis. You've had summer and now people are back to, a normal. September is a month where things return to normal. And certainly in Europe and in other parts of the world, you're seeing a second wave. So it doesn't surprise me that that has some impact on optimism. But, you know, our industry is not going anywhere. This business and hospitality at every level is extraordinarily robust and is thousands of years old. People have a thirst for travel and they have a need for travel. And as much as we might all have realized that we can do business over, you know, a computer in this way, there is still a great fundamental desire for human connectivity, whether it's in business or on a personal level. So for sure, it's not going to be a crisis that has an immediate or quick rebound. You know, we're certainly and researching heavily what we're believing for 2021 as we put our budgets together. And we believe it's going to be significantly behind how we ended 2019, forget 2020. But, you know, we're modeling on that basis. But it is a process of recovery. So as Sandeep said earlier, I would echo, I'm optimistic by nature. I'm optimistic for our industry. But I think 2021 will be a year of slow recovery and full recovery will come in 2022.
I think we all agree with that. Sandeep, you want to add your perspective?
Sure, I think I agree with Simon in terms of a ramp up into 2021 and then looking at 2022. But I think I would just add another perspective because when we talk hotels, I think we automatically lean towards the room business. I think a big part of, for example, when we look at UAE, we have 300 restaurants. And it's a big part, food and beverage is a big part of it. It's about 39-40% of our revenues come from food and beverage. So I think that's another one to look at and dissect. And if you look at that part of our business, as I was mentioning earlier, there has been a pent-up demand. UAE has done a brilliant job in being very fast in the beginning. It had very good speed to market. It closed very quickly. It had night curfews. It had lockdowns. They cleaned it up very, very quickly. A city or a country which is already known for hygiene and cleanliness, they went the other extreme. But then they were able to kind of reach the peak and then reopen as well. So if today you had to go out in Dubai or Abu Dhabi, most of the restaurants are open. You'll be surprised. Yes, with social distancing, the tables, but most of the restaurants are doing very well because there is a demand. If people are not ready to, they're not able to travel, they are going to restaurants. And we've in fact seen a lot of our restaurants doing even better than last year. So I think that kind of lends to the optimism again and leans to the fact that if it's open, we are going there. And when travel opens, that pent-up demand for travel will come too.
Fantastic. It's great to to end on a positive note. We hope you have all enjoyed our conversation. Simon, Sandeep, Bastien, thank you so much for your time and interesting perspectives. Please remember to go to the Forbes Travel Guide YouTube channel for a full global picture of the state of our industry and for more valuable insights. Thank you very much, everybody, and have a wonderful day.